Now it is. Hi, I think we're going to get started today. So it's my pleasure to introduce Rajiv Vibhakar. How'd that go? Rajiv is, as all of you know, I think, or many of you probably know, an associate professor here in the Department of Pediatrics. But I'll give you a little bit of his history. He did his MD-PhD degree at the New York Medical College. What I didn't know until I looked at his bio sketch carefully was that he also has an MPH. So he's an MD-PhD and an MPH also from New York Medical College. He then went on to do his pediatric residency at the University of Iowa, and he was there as a resident and fellow and actually moved up through the ranks as a professor or assistant professor and I believe associate professor also before we recruited him away here at the University of Colorado, which I'm really happy we did because Rajiv and I have been collaborating for some time now, and he is the go-to person if you want to understand medulloblastoma. So as many of you probably know, both clinically and in his research life, Rajiv works on medulloblastoma, and he's done a lot of different things in that disease, looking at microRNAs, looking at doing kinome screens, and looking at critical kinases that you might target. He's looked at epigenetic regulators, which I believe is what he's going to talk about today. And he's also been involved not only in the more basic science, trying to understand new vulnerabilities of medulloblastoma, but also in a clinical consortiums where he's been part of larger groups that have collected tissue and done large-scale genomic and expression type of analysis. I think he was recently on the couple of papers, at least one of the two papers that just came out in Nature describing numerous different subgroups in medulloblastoma. So with that, it's a pleasure to have him talk to us today about epigenetic vulnerabilities in pediatric tumors.
Thanks, Haida. I'm really glad I got to come and talk. I've been wanting to basically roll out the new car for the last little bit. We've been working on a lot of these kinds of epigenetic vulnerability projects over the last year and a half, and I feel like I'm really loud. Okay. So I've been wanting to kind of show off some of the data that the people in the lab have been doing because it's been pretty cool what they've been working on. So in full disclosure, Sujata, whose picture is up there, basically runs the lab, and I just show up every once in a while. So a lot of the stuff that you're going to look at today has really been a lot of her driving a lot of the things, and all the people in the lab that actually do all this stuff. So this is why we do this. This is some really well-known scientific journals that you can see that pediatric cancer is now the leading cause of death in children with cancer causes. And this has sort of been the driving force for many decades. Leukemia was the number one killer, primarily because of the number of patients that had leukemia were far greater than the number of patients with cancer. But given the improved therapeutics for various kinds of leukemia, not all, but a lot of them, the mortality rate has declined significantly in leukemia. But unfortunately for brain tumors, we're far, far behind. And so this is really the big driving force for what drives me on any given day. So one of the things about pediatric brain tumors is that they're pretty complex. This is just from the 2016 WHO update on classification of brain tumors. And you can see they've classified them in multiple different ways. And this is just one of the snapshots of all of the different possibilities that was in the update. And the point being that they can be classified in many different ways. The nice part is the 2016 update now actually includes specific molecular definitions of tumors, so it's not purely based on histology alone anymore, but there are specific molecular definitions of various tumors, and that's really helped us to kind of really think about how we chase some of these tumors. But it also makes it a little bit more difficult because you have this large heterogeneous group, and how do you kind of go about looking at specific targets? And my lab and sort of our approach has always been about trying to understand some of the biology behind these brain tumors, but always with the perspective that what is a vulnerability that we can then exploit for therapeutic purposes. So a lot of the work we do is sort of in that realm of basic to translational work, trying to identify new potential targets for therapy. So I'm going to talk about these four tumor types today And really, this is what drives us. So medulloblastoma, and I work on the MYC-driven medulloblastoma subgroup, which has that 30% survival that you see up there, atypical rhabdoid tumors. The infants have a 25-30% survival. Ependymoma is at a 5 years at 55%. If you go to 10 years, that's significantly lower. And then the diffuse midline glioma basically is zero, although there's a few odd survivors. So I always say less than 3% because zero is probably not completely accurate. So this is why we do this. This is clearly a difficult situation. The key is all of these tumors have singular molecular lesions from which you can understand biology and from which you can then chase potential interacting partners and try to understand what the vulnerabilities are that the tumors are addicted to because of the specific mutation that has occurred in them. And we'll talk about those in more specific detail as we talk about these tumors. So one of the major issues with pediatric tumors relative to adult cancers that we always talk about is the fact that pediatric tumors have a much lower genetic burden of mutations compared to adult counterparts. So you can see in the green here are all pediatric cancers, brain tumors as well as leukemias and other solid tumors. And you can see that if you look at mutations per megabase, they're much significantly lower compared to all of the adult cancers, except for this small group up here of pediatric cancers. And these are patients that have genetic predispositions to DNA repair issues, and they certainly have a much higher level of mutations. But in general, they tend to have much lower burden of mutations, which is good and bad. It's good because you don't have a completely messed up chromosomes that you can that make it difficult to look for and treat diseases. But the flip side to that is there's also far fewer targetable mutations, so you are much more difficult compared to, say, lung cancer or colon cancer, where you have multiple different mutations that are in signaling pathways that are potentially targetable. So there's always a plus minus of trying to understand how do we chase specific molecular lesions in pediatric cancers and pediatric brain tumors specifically that we could potentially look for therapeutic purposes. So there have been a lot of studies done, and here's just a few of them, really looking at sort of this large-scale genetic studies identifying alterations. So you can see here I'm part of a big group called the MAGIC Consortium, which does a lot of large-scale genomics, and you can see they've done a lot of structural variations across thousands of genomes and identified a lot of lesions in medulloblastoma, similarly in rhabdoid tumors. Rhabdoid tumors are very interesting because they actually have almost no mutations relative to anything else except for their single gene deletion that is the hallmark for that tumor. But the problem is with a lot of these things, whole exome studies, whole genome studies, we found a lot of some mutations, we found a lot of alterations in genomic variants, but very few targetable lesions. And this has kind of been the ongoing recurring theme, particularly with brain tumors, is that there's very few targetable lesions that have been identified from which you can then chase. So even though we have a lot of genetic data, the use of that data for actual development of therapies is long ways off, if at all. So the other obvious area to look at is epigenetic regulation. And that's what I got interested in about five, six years ago. And one of the reasons was there were several studies, including this one right here, talking about some genetic mutations that are actually altering epigenetic regulators. And so to me, it was like, well, that's an interesting concept if epigenetic regulators are altered. So the ones in gray are some of the ones that have been identified in various pediatric brain tumors. And the ones in blue are some of the things that we've done in the past, looking at gene expression data, various genetic lesions to try to identify regulators of epigenetic regulation that might be potential targetable therapies, and some of these are actually targetable, and there are drugs that are already in clinical trials for some of these. But a lot of this data is from, you know, looking at the genomic data, kind of trying to pick out things that you think are cool and interesting, and on a single level basis trying to identify targets. That doesn't really help when you have somewhere between 400 and 500 genes that are associated with epigenetic regulation or chromatin regulation, and the question is which of these are actually really important for brain tumors. So we've got a few that we've identified, but which ones are really critical? So that was sort of the question that we wanted to kind of chase and say, what is really going on at this level? Well, if you think about it in that context, then you have to think about where within the epigenetic regulation landscape are you going to look at. So when we talk about epigenetic regulation, there's multiple levels, right? So you have your chromatin that's compacted completely. It's compacted with nucleosomes. The nucleosomes all have DNA wrapped around them. That DNA itself is methylated, and so you have alterations of the chromatin packaging, you have alterations of the nucleosomes, you have alteration of the histones that allow for the nucleosomes to be built, you have alterations of the DNA around which the nucleosomes are constructed. And all of these things alter, essentially, at the end of the day, gene expression and transcription of genes or silencing of genes. And so there's multiple different regulators and multiple different levels of mechanism where one can go to look for some of these targets. So then you go back to the sort of story of what are we thinking about? Well, I'm going to focus on the histone modification piece of it for today. So if you look at histone modification, histone proteins make the core of your nucleosomes, and they all have a peptide or protein tail which has multiple residues on it that can be altered. I'm going to just talk about the lysine residues today. There's arginine residues, there's some phosphor residues, there's a bunch of other things that also get altered. But if we talk about it in the context of the lysine residues that we know are altered, you have genes that add the methylation marks onto these various residues. So, for example, you have MLL2 that will methylate the K4 residue on a histone, or EZH2 that will methylate the K27 residue on a histone, and the K4 tends to be more permissive for transcription, and the K27 methylation tends to be more restrictive for transcription. So they act in opposite ways. So you have a lot of enzymes that work to add these marks. You have the opposite. You have a bunch of enzymes that work to take off these methylation marks and work in the opposite way to try to regulate that dynamic. And it's always a balance of, it's never an all or none situation with most epigenetic regulation. It's a matter of the balance between how many residues are methylated that are permissive versus how many residues that are methylated that are restrictive, and the location of those residues. And then you have a lot of proteins that bind to these various residues to transduce signals downstream. And so this is sort of the large scale context in which you would want to look for epigenetic regulators. And I'm not even talking about the chromatin modifying enzymes that are ATP dependent, and we'll talk about them briefly towards the end. So there's a lot of enzymes to look at. There's a lot of proteins to look at. As I mentioned before, we've looked at EZH2 and validated that. We've looked at BRD4. We've validated that as potential targets. But really, that's just from looking at the literature, from looking at gene expression data that we have in our lab from various tumor types and so on. So the question is, how do we go about doing this in a more systematic and unbiased way? So what we started out doing was doing a large-scale RNAi screen targeting all epigenetic regulators or proteins annotated to have some sort of chromatin-modifying domain or role. So that we came up with a list of 406. There's actually probably a few more than that, but that was sort of the list that we started with. So we worked with a company to create a shRNA pool that had 4,399 shRNAs targeting all of these genes in a lentiviral backbone. And we took our tumor cells, and we started out with medulloblastoma as our first tumor model, and we transduced our medulloblastoma cells. So the concept is that if you do your math right and you maintain your cell culture correctly, you should have one shRNA per cell. And so then you now have a pool of cells with this that have an shRNA in them. You allow them to grow for epigenetic regulators. You want them to have a longer-term passage rate, so we let them go for 3 to 5 passages. It's about 21 days. And we look to see if there are shRNAs that are critical for targeting genes that are critical for growth, you should deplete them. If there's ones that are allowing your cells to grow faster, you should enrich for those shRNAs so you can wait for them. You can seek isolated DNA, sequence them, and identify what's missing and what's present. So we did this for the medulloblastoma initially and started working on it. But as we were doing that, we realized, well, you know, that's great. We've identified some nice hits in medulloblastoma, and we can validate them. But are they real? Are they just medulloblastoma, or is it some general cancer thing? Is it some general brain tumor thing? Is it just a general neuronal thing? Who knows, right? So the question is, how do we go about really seeing what is going on? So what we did was we did a similar screen in sort of the four major types of brain tumors that tend to be the most aggressive. So these are the MYC-driven medulloblastomas, the DIPGs, which have a single have a mutation in the histone 3 K27, and I will talk about that in a little bit more detail. And the ATRTs, which have a loss of the SMARCB1 gene as their main driving force, and then the ependymomas, which have two or three major genetic changes. And so when we do this, and then we overlay all of this data to say, all right, what shRNAs are unique to each individual tumor type, or which shRNAs are common, and how do we go about this? Clearly, this generates a lot of data, and obviously we cannot chase all of these targets. So we then have to look and see what are our top hits. We use a variety of informatic and statistical processes to prioritize our genes, sort of the top hits, and then kind of chase them from there. So I'll tell you about several things. We identified the compass-like complex as a major hit in the MYC-driven medulloblastoma. We identified SIRT2 as a major hit in ATRT and a lower hit in ependymoma. And then we identified BMI1 in DIPG, and it turns out actually BMI1 is also known as a target in medulloblastoma from about a decade and a half ago. So it actually is a hit in multiple different tumor types. So I'll tell you about those three. We've worked on several other molecules as well, but these three sort of have the most data. So I'll talk to you a little bit about that. So the first one I want to talk to you about is the compass-like complex. What was interesting to us was that actually almost every single component of this complex was a hit in our screen. That was actually pretty surprising to me. It was not just one of the components, but almost every single component. And most of the components actually had four or more shRNAs. So we use a minimum of at least two shRNAs from the pool have to be a hit for us to consider that protein a hit to move forward with. But in this particular case, in the compass-like complex, almost all of them were hits, and in at least three out of four replicates. So this was exciting. This was interesting to understand why is this important. So the compass-like complex actually regulates H3K4 methylation and tends to be important for permissive gene transcription. So if we look at the histone tail, there's the residue at the position 4, lysine 4, and that lysine 4 can get monomethylated and work at enhancer regions, or trimethylated, work at promoter regions. In the context of the trimethylation, you have all of the compass-like proteins complex that trimethylate at K4, and if they do that, they tend to allow for permissive gene transcription, and we think allow for transcription of differentiation programs. So first, we went ahead and did an independent validation of the RNA screen, and here's just using independent shRNAs. You can see that compared to the null shRNA, all of the various components, if we knock them down, decrease colony formation significantly. So what we found in the shRNA pool is consistent to what we found independently knocking down, and you can see here just quantifying the number of colonies for all the various components of the compass-like complex. So we wanted to go ahead and sort of validate or look at biology and try to understand what this complex is doing. So we decided to work on one of the components, WDR5, and try to understand what it's doing in our medulloblastoma cells. We picked WDR5 for a couple of reasons. One, there was actually a publication about 2 years ago that showed structurally that WDR5 can bind to MYC. And they actually did a very nice work defining what the various protein interfaces were that would bind WDR5 to MYC. And so since we're looking at MYC-driven medulloblastoma, it seemed the protein to chase. So initially we did some fairly simple studies looking at what happens if we knock down WDR5 with shRNAs. So one of the essays we did was to look at the stem cell regulation. And the reason we started thinking about cell self-renewal and stem cell regulation is the MLL complex is well known in leukemia to regulate hematopoiesis and hematopoietic progenitor cells, and is also known to be part of translocations that occur in a variety of leukemias. So when we knock down WDR5 with shRNAs and look for neurosphere formation, what we find is that at 7 days with a null vector, we get nice neurospheres forming. But if we knock down WDR5, we get really poor neurospheres. You can see that the size of the neurospheres is significantly smaller, sort of also suggesting that the WDR5 is somehow regulating the neurosphere formation. Sort of the classical method for looking at cell self-renewal is to do a limiting dilution assay and understanding what happens. So in a limiting dilution assay, you take multiple colonies of single cell cultures and then try to identify if those single cells can form new neurospheres, and you can do that in multiple levels. So if we seed 31 wells with a single cell, 22 out of 31 will form new neurospheres under the SH null conditions, but only 12 of 29 can form new neurospheres under knockdown of WDR5, suggesting that there's a defect in self-renewal of cells under neural stem cell conditions with knockdown of WDR5. So we looked at what happens if we do this in a normal cell. So these cells are human cerebellar neural stem cells that have been transduced with MYC, and so they are immortalized, but they're not transformed. They won't grow as tumors. If we take those cells and we knock down WDR5, you can see here that they kind of sit down, they form neurites, and they express marker TUJ1, which is a marker of neural differentiation. So that essentially, by knocking down WDR5, we're driving differentiation of these neural stem cells. And if you look at qPCR gene expression of a variety of pluripotency genes, such as NANOG, OCT4, SOX2, they all are significantly decreased by knocking down WDR5, whereas if we look at TUJ1, which should go up, and it does if we inhibit WDR5, suggesting there's a switch between self-renewal or pluripotency and differentiation of these neural stem cells. And the same thing happens if we do this with our medulloblastoma cell lines. We get a significant induction of differentiation and a significant decrease in pluripotency genes in the tumor cells as well. So since somebody had described that WDR5 physically binds to MYC, we wanted to see what the dependency between MYC was and WDR5 was. So one nice tool that was developed in the mid-90s, actually by Michael Bishop, was these retinal pigment epithelial cells. What they've done is they've either transduced them with neomycin or with a MYC-expressing vector. And so these cells will grow, they're immortalized, they grow in culture, and you can look for MYC-dependent mechanisms. So if we do that, we look at these RPE cells, and we knock down, if we use just the SH null, they grow nicely. You can see that the you have a nice log phase growth with the null. If you knock down WDR5, you get a decrease in the proliferation of these cells, about a 50% decrease, but the cells still grow without MYC as a driving force in these cells. If you use the RPE MYC cells and you knock down WDR5, the cells stop growing completely. And so clearly there's a MYC dependency between WDR5 and MYC activity, at least from this model of looking at MYC activity as a dependent factor for WDR5. We've done some other work looking at the coordination between WDR5 and MYC, and we've been able to see that there's a co-occupancy at the promoter level between MYC and WDR5 that might explain some of these mechanisms. If we do this in vivo, what we find is that if we knock down WDR5 and grow tumors in mice, in mouse brains and mouse cerebella in this particular case, the knockdown of WDR5 does prolong survival over time. And you can see that with the SH null, you get these nice large tumors forming that here are labeled with K67, which is just a marker of proliferation. And that if you knock down WDR5, or you try to induce tumors with a knockdown of WDR5, you get much smaller tumors, and the animals live longer in the xenografts. Again, sort of showing in vivo that knocking down WDR5 might be a way to think about for potential therapeutic purposes. The interesting thing is that WDR5 can actually initiate tumors in our MYC-driven neural progenitor cells. So here's we can take our MYC-driven neural stem cells that I just showed you and put in just either GFP or WDR5. if you put in GFP, the cells are, because the cells are immortalized but not transformed, they don't really form tumors, and you just get a normal cerebellum. Whereas if you put in WDR5 into our neural stem cells and then put them into mice, you actually form tumors in animals. So it's showing that WDR5 is enough to initiate medulloblastoma tumorigenesis in combination with MYC. And this is just our initial set of experiments to show that one out of the six GFP animals did actually form a tumor, but five out of six WDR5 ones. It's suggesting that clearly WDR5 allows MYC to transform these cells into tumors. So it'll be interesting to now try to think about what the mechanisms are in these tumors, and whether there's a what we think is going on at the chromatin level is actually going on in the tumors. So this was really nice because it kind of gives us an idea that WDR5 is a good place to start. But what's the point of all of this? And the reason is that there's actually a chemical biology lab up at Princess Margaret in Toronto that's been developing inhibitors of the WDR5-MLL2 interaction. And so here's sort of their tool compound. And you can see that if you treat our medulloblastoma cells with their inhibitor, you get a decrease in growth, you get a decrease in neurosphere formation, which is similar to what we find with our genetic knockdowns. Same thing happens to neurosphere size. What I didn't show in sort of the previous data is that genetic knockdown showed us that there's actually a significant induction of senescence in the medulloblastoma cells, and that's similar to what happens with the drug. You get a significant induction of senescence. This is just showing the beta-galactosidase staining, which is one way of looking at senescence. And then if you look at senescence-associated genes like P21, it goes up, and then genes in the G1 cell cycle phase like E2F or phospho-RB all go down. And interestingly, the H3K4 trimethylation is significantly suppressed as well by OICR. So the tool compound that they have for this interaction really works well. The tool compound itself is not great in terms of its cell permeability, so it works okay for some basic in vitro studies, but it's not the ideal sort of compound to really study going forward. They've developed a suite of about 17 different agents off of this molecule, and we've tested all of them and identified two that are highly potent. I have no idea what they are. They've just sent them to me as numbers. But there's two that are really very good, and so we're working with those now to try to identify if those will work in vivo and whether that's a actual druggable prospect moving forward for MYC-driven medulloblastoma. So I try to tell my fellows and my postdocs and grad students this, but it doesn't always go over that well. I just wanted to switch gears a little bit and now talk a little bit about the ATRT. So ATRT is a tumor, also a malignant brain tumor, where SMARCB1 is the hallmark of ATRTs. So the SMARCB1 is a part of the SWI/SNF complex that regulates chromatin packaging. Here it's labeled as INI1, which is the same thing. As you can see, it's part of a fairly large complex that regulates chromatin compaction. And in ATRT, you have loss of INI1 either because it's deleted or there's mutations that cause truncated protein synthesis. And so all ATRT tumors, by definition, are INI1 deficient. We don't know for sure exactly how the SMARCB1 deletion drives tumorigenesis. There's a lot of data out there suggesting that it regulates various parts of the cell cycle. It regulates some interferon-mediated pathways. There's a variety of other things that happen. There's some beautiful work done by Charlie Roberts over the last 2 years, really, showing that there might be a different way of looking at things, and that is that if you have your complete wild-type SWI/SNF complex, you have antagonism of PRC2, which we've shown as well, and that if in that context you have a balance between your differentiation genes and your self-renewal genes because you have the wild-type SWI/SNF. If you have SMARCB1 deleted, it's not that you don't have the complex at all, but you actually essentially have a residual complex that probably still binds to the genes that are associated with self-renewal. but does not bind to the parts of the chromatin that are associated with differentiation programs. And so you have a suppression of differentiation programs and a continued abnormal activation of self-renewal programs that probably drives ATRT. So in this context, the question again is, how do you go about thinking about targeting this complex? The SMARCB1 is not targetable. The SWI/SNF complex itself is not targetable. We've shown that there are some downstream molecules that are regulated by SWI/SNF that could be potential therapeutic targets. So we did the RNA screen, and one of the genes that we identified was SIRT2. It was actually the top hit in our entire screen. And so the question is, what the heck does SIRT2 do? SIRT2is a protein lysine deacetylase. It has a lot of roles primarily that have been described primarily in aging and in neurodegeneration. Its role in cancer is not very well known. There's a couple of manuscripts in the literature suggesting that it's associated with, in breast cancer, is associated with several genes. But outside of that, there's very little known about how SIRT2 might regulate tumorigenesis. We kind of looked at whether knockdown of SIRT2 independently would indeed actually stop ATRT cells from growing. And this is a cell line that we've established here. And you can see that if you knock down SIRT2, you actually get a significant decrease in proliferation. There is actually a drug out there called Tenovin 6, and it's actually an inhibitor of SIRT1 and SIRT2, but it works fairly well. But again, if we drug the cells with Tenovin 6, you can see that you get a decrease in cell growth. Again, just suggesting that SIRT2 probably is a regulator in the context of SMARCB1 deletion. What it exactly does was sort of the next major question that we had. So we knocked down SIRT2 and did some RNA-seq to try to identify genomic programs that are related to knockdown of SIRT2 in the context of SMARCB1 deletion. And what was interesting to us was that mixed signaling and P53 signaling were sort of the top hits out of the GSEA. And so that was actually very, very interesting to us, particularly the mixed signaling piece, because we've shown that mixed signaling is actually a large component of SMARCB1 deletion. And people have actually shown that if you do large-scale analysis of the genomics of genomic programs in ATRT patient samples, you can split them into three genomic subgroups, and one of those genomic subgroups has a high signature for MYC-driven signaling, and those are the patients that do the worst. So MYC certainly has a role to play in the SMARCB1 deleted rhabdoid tumors. So if you look at these two cell lines here, it's just an example of what happens if you knock down SIRT2. We do see a slight decrease in SIRT2 protein. It's interesting that it's not that huge, but we see a significant decrease in MYC, and we see a significant increase in P53. We also see an increase in acetylation of alpha tubulin, which is sort of the canonical known role of SIRT2. So we know that SIRT2 regulates acetylation of alpha tubulin, so you can always use that as sort of your positive regulator. And so we can see that clearly knocking down SIRT2 does what it's supposed to do, but it also does both targets MYC and P53 signaling. So potentially there's a role there to play in terms of its genomic stability role, which has been described in Alzheimer's disease, but is unclear what it does in the context of cancer. So we developed some in vivo models to look at some of these things. So here's just an orthotopic model of growing ATRT cells in a mouse cerebella in this particular case. And for Natalie, I put in the MRIs that they did for us. And you can see here with the vehicle, you see this nice big tumor. This is looking at a mouse nose on. So you're looking straight down the snout of a mouse. And you can see this nice big tumor, whereas if you look here, you see that the tumor is significantly smaller if you have treated the cells with Tenovin 6 in vivo. And when we do this study and we harvest these tumors and we look at the tumors, you can see that the Tenovin 6 treated tumors are significantly smaller compared to those. So again, suggesting that targeting SIRT2 would be a great thing. Tenovin 6 is great. There's actually already a couple of clinical trials and again various aging related diseases. The downside to Tenovin 6 is that it is a SIRT1 and 2 inhibitor, and we really wanted to look for what happens to specifically to SIRT2. Fortunately for us, there's a chemical biology group at the University of Michigan that developed a SIRT2 inhibitor that is very specific for SIRT2, and they've labeled it TM for now. So we then did the similar sets of studies using TM as our agent, and basically what we were able to show is that if you treat the rhabdoid tumors with TM and then you do immunohistochemistry of those tumors, here's the control-treated cells, and here's the TM-treated cells. So you can see there's a high level of Ki-67 staining, which is, again, highly proliferative cells, which you would expect from ATRT tumors. And there's a significantly decreased proliferation if the tumor animals have been treated with TM. Similarly, if you stain for Caspase-3, which is a marker of apoptosis in our tumor tissues, treatment with TM significantly induces apoptosis in these tumors. And at the same thing happens for MYC. There's a lot of MYC in these tumors, and the MYC level goes down in these tissues if you treat them with TM. And more importantly, if you treat the animals with the drug over time, you actually get a significant prolongation of survival. And we actually stopped treating these animals at 24 days and let them go to see what would happen. And so you can see that eventually the animals do die. But you can significantly decrease rate of ATRT growth in these animals. So this suggests that TM would be a really great drug for use in ATRT. The question is, do you use it alone? Do you use it with other chemotherapy agents? Do you use it with radiation? What is it really doing at the genetic level in these cells? And so those are all studies that are ongoing to try to understand how is SIRT2 regulating ATRT growth from a biological perspective, but also what agents would we want to combine with TM to actually use as a therapeutic backbone in ATRT. So I just want to switch gears again and talk a little bit about sort of the last piece. And again, the reason for sort of doing all vignettes of several of these projects to show that there are specific epigenetic vulnerabilities that are different in different brain tumors, but that are context specific that one can actually really look at. So the other tumor I really wanted to talk about is diffuse midline glioma. This is the tumor that essentially nobody survives. So this tumor occurs very clearly in the midline in the brain, and they are all associated with histone K27 lysine to methionine mutations. And they also tend to have some other mutations occurring with or without them, including some P53 mutations. But these are exclusive to midline gliomas. They don't occur in the high-grade gliomas that occur in the cortex. Those have different mutations, also in histone, but those mutations are G34 to R or G34 to V mutations. So we'll talk about the H3K27M mutations. Biologically, it's fascinating because you're trying to understand what this one single mutation, point mutation, does to the entire, to create such aggressive tumors. So we had identified BMI-1 as a target in these DIPG. So the initial study we did, again, was to knock down BMI-1 to see what happens, and we get a significant decrease in cell growth from various DIPG cell lines. We also did a variety of neurosphere assays, and again, knocking down BMI-1 significantly depletes the self-renewal of these cells. The other thing we did was, again, we oftentimes look at these targets from the perspective of, is there any chemical inhibitors on the horizon? And for DIPGs, there's a small pharmaceutical company called PTC Therapeutics that has developed several inhibitors of DIPG, of BMI-1. PTC-209 was their initial compound. They've actually created some better ones now that we are hopefully going to obtain once our university tech transfer office allows us to obtain the drug from the company. But if you take PTC-209, which you can purchase from any chemical company, and you treat DIPG cells with the drug, you can see that you significantly decrease cell growth in a dose-dependent manner with the DIPG cells. What was actually interesting to us was when we did our initial RNAi studies, where there was a clear suggestion that the knockdown of BMI-1 was actually preventing cells from migrating, which is really important in DIPGs because they essentially fill out the entire pons and are highly invasive through the midbrain into the thalamus and beyond. And so the invasive migration component of it is actually a key component of biology for these midline gliomas. So if we treat these cells and do a variety of assays looking at cell migration and cell invasion, what we see is that if you treat them with just DMSO or a low dose of the PTC drug, they still move and still migrate. But once you start to increase the dose of the drug and inhibit BMI-1, you start to see a significant decrease in the migration and the moving ability of these tumors, suggesting that actually we might be able to target one of the parts of the tumor biology that is particularly problematic in these tumors, which is their ability to be highly invasive within the various tissues. So the other part that we chased was looking at cellular senescence, primarily because BMI-1 is well known in hematopoietic systems to drive regulation of a variety of genes in the G1 phase of the cell cycle. It's well known to suppress P16 and a variety of other tumor suppressors. And what we find is that if you knock down BMI-1, in this particular case with an shRNA, the same thing happens with drug. You get significant increase of beta galactosidase-positive cells indicating senescence, and you also get an increase in a variety of tumor suppressors such as P16 and P21. So the next study we were trying to understand is what is the connection between BMI-1 and the H3K27M? So to do that, we've looked at it in our DIPG cells, which already have the mutation. But to kind of take that next step, what we did was we took AM38 glioma cells. These are cells that normally harbor a wild-type histone. And if you introduce the H3K27M mutant histone into these cells, you actually see a significant shift in gene expression. I'm just showing you a few examples here, but you get a significant increase in BMI-1. You get a significant increase in GFAP, which is a marker of progenitor cells within the glial population. You get a significant increase of OLIG2, which is another marker of oligodendroglial progenitor cells. And you get a significant increase in SOX2, which is a marker of pluripotency in a variety of neurons and stem cells in the brain. So just by introducing the mutant histone into already transformed glioma cells, we can significantly shift their genomic programs to a much more progenitor-like state. And when we do RNA-seq, we essentially see the same thing. We get signatures that are associated with ES cells go up significantly relative to wild-type. So we confirmed the BMI-1 induction with Westerns. And again, if you put in the K27M mutant into wild-type cells, you get a significant induction of of BMI-1. What's more interesting is that if you really look at what happens once we introduce the K27M, we see the mutant go up, which we would hope to do, and we get global decrease in histone K27 trimethylation, which has been described previously. The mutant protein seems to take over from the native protein, and you lose the trimethylation of histones that's there. So we saw that. But what we saw that was really interesting was that we get an increase in the ubiquitination of lysine 119. That's important because that's the lysine that gets ubiquitinated by PRC1, which is the complex that BMI-1 is part of and that drives gene transcription. So not only are we getting an increase in BMI-1 expression, but we're actually getting an increase in BMI-1 activity downstream. The interesting question really now is, where is that occurring? Where is that just global, or is that focal to specific areas of the chromatin where there are specific genes that are being induced? And the only way to answer that is with ChIP-seq, which is sort of what we're working on right now to try to really understand how does BMI-1 regulate the differences once you get the K27M induced. But the interesting part is what happens to cells when you put in K27M. So here's your wild-type glioma cells. They're already transformed and fairly aggressive. You put in the K27M, and they just completely take off, and they grow much faster with just the K27M introduced. If you take the wild-type cells and you knock down BMI-1, you get a slight decrease, if at all, in the growth of those wild-type histone glioma cells. But if you take the mutant cells now and you knock down BMI-1, you get a significant decrease in the cell growth, suggesting that whatever interaction K27M is having with BMI-1, the K27M-driven program is really dependent on BMI-1 to drive that biology. And if you knock out BMI-1, that K27M can no longer drive whatever tumorigenic process is driving it. And that's sort of our global hypothesis for this. And so we're now starting to look more detailed molecularly at how does K27M regulate BMI-1, what happens at the chromatin level, what happens at the histone lysine level, and kind of how does this process work? Because if that is a mechanism of action and BMI-1 is truly targetable, now you have a sort of specific molecular vulnerability that you can target in the context of K27M mutant tumors. So we think that brain tumors really are dependent on a lot of epigenetic mechanisms, both to initiate and maintain tumorigenesis. And from my perspective, if we identify some of these mechanisms and truly start to understand them, we can really start to develop new therapeutic strategies targeting these tumors, particularly since a lot of new small pharma are developing more and more inhibitors for a whole variety of epigenetic regulators. And so if we can truly identify which of these regulators are important for which of these different tumors, we can actually potentially leverage some of these new inhibitors towards it. And I think that using a functional genomic strategy to target them is a good way of going about it, because then you have an unbiased way of really trying to identify which ones are important relative to the ones that you think are important. And because of that, we now have all of the data that we've generated allows us to now hopefully keep us busy for a long while trying to understand how these different epigenetic regulators work in the context of the tumors that we've studied, but also in the context of how they cooperate with each other to drive these tumorigenesis or interact with each other. And from my clinical hat perspective, potential for dual and triple targeting of tumors for therapy. And really the big thing is all the people in the lab. The nice part for me is that we have a really robust pediatric brain tumor program here. So myself, Nick, Jean, Adam, all have labs that are doing a lot of different aspects of pediatric brain tumors, and we all are together, so it allows us to kind of share a lot of our resources together. And then the nice part is both Katie Dorris and Lindsay Hoffman are over in the clinical side are driving a lot of these, hopefully, protocols into clinical trials. I've already done from work that we've done over the last few years, driving new clinical protocols. So hopefully we can drive a lot of these things. And then, of course, our funding sources for keeping us going. And then my family for allowing me to do what I do. Thank you. So that's a great question. So the Compass complex, for example, I would have never identified from gene expression data. They're not really that much higher. So it's not that they're necessarily higher. They're just functionally important once you have a lot of MYC. So if you have tumors that don't have a lot of MYC, they don't seem to be – the tumor cells are not dependent on that pathway. But once you have a lot of MYC, the tumor cells seem to be dependent on those proteins to keep driving whatever it is that MYC is driving. So we would have never identified, and I didn't for the first 6 years that I was studying, or 7 years that I've been doing medulloblastoma biology. I wouldn't have even looked at those things because they're really not on our gene expression data. And we've looked at thousands of samples, and really this is not there. But once you do a functional analysis like this, you suddenly identify nodes that are functionally relevant that may not be significantly overexpressed.
That sort of brings me to my question. Do you know if, developmentally, the MYC
correct.
Where
yeah.
You have more MYC,
yeah.
Now utilizing right. Other epigenetic.
Yeah. 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 So that's a good question. From a brain perspective, we don't know. So in hematopoietic systems, there's a clear developmental role for the various set components In driving the progression of hematopoietic stem cells. In the brain, it's just really not known what the roles are. There have been a few studies looking at, for example, hippocampal neurons and showing that if you don't have an insufficient complex, you get degradation of hippocampal neurons. What that necessarily means overall, we're not sure. But there's not been a lot of detailed studies looking at the role of these complexes in normal development. So that's a good question. We really think it's the MYC that allows for that dependency to occur because of the things that MYC does. So. MLL1, right. Correct. So you asked me this last time, and I did go back and look, and set one is a hit. It's just statistically lower on the list, but it is a hit, and MLL1 is also a hit on the list. The others are not. So the ML1 and SET1B were both on the SET1D were both on the hit list, just not didn't hit our cutoff, a statistical cutoff.
And so the other example is about the OSTR compound.
Yeah.
Experiment. So your title was that it inhibits the neurology.
Right. Right.
But you know it also inhibits the MYC interaction? I can't remember.
So we don't know. So all of the descriptions. So all the descriptions are related to what protein-protein interfaces it binds to, and based on on that structural data, it should be WDR5 MLL2. I don't think anybody's actually looked at whether it alters MYC and WDR5 binding, and that's actually a great point because we've done co-IPs looking at MYC and WDR5 binding and shown that they do bind together. So we could easily actually look and see if they fall apart. That's a good point. Correct. Yeah, I'm actually hoping that they'll give me the other compounds because they're about tenfold better than this OICR compound, and so if I can use those, then it's just a lot easier to probe what's going on because we have to use 5 micromolar here, and it's not that great. Yeah. Yeah, so that's a good point. And so I don't know. Is one of my postdocs here? She just did a whole bunch of gamma HOAX staining and things like that. And I haven't seen that data yet. So because that was one of the questions: if it's a p53 driven process, is this a DNA damage related issue? I think in one of the neurodegenerative disease processes, it actually maybe regulates replication stress. And so potentially CDC7, so maybe that's a mechanism. So there's definitely a lot of avenues to explore to see exactly what it's doing. Yeah.